Hello and welcome to the latest episode of The Good Drum Show with me, Chris Goodrum. Okay, so this week we've got finally got the random episodes of the show out of the way, so it's kind of back to normal. We'll be looking at some new releases and stuff like that, and you can obviously tell from the cover shot this week we're looking at the Thomas & Kubokan range. Don't think I'm going to have any comments about my pronunciation of Tomatin somehow. Don't think anything wrong with that, but anyway, that's by the by. So basically, I'm really looking forward to this. You know, this is the first time I've tasted all of the range, all of the currently available range, shall we say, in one go. There is one other bottling that has been released of their peated spirit, the 1989 distilled spirit, which I don't have a sample of, but you know, I've got, like I said, I've got the currently available bottling, so I think this should be really, really interesting. Now, the peated spirit, I believe, was never actually intended for release. They started producing it back in 2005 purely as to use in blending, and the thing is with distilleries that, or should I say, companies that produce blended whiskey that don't have an Islay distillery in their portfolio, you essentially have two ways of rectifying that. Either you sign a contract with one of the Islay distilleries to supply you regularly with spirit, or you do it yourself. And if you do it yourself, then obviously you've got, you know, a lot more control over quality. Well, not necessarily quality, but the continuity, I guess, of style. So it's always going to be pretty much the same. You're not beheld to a distillery maybe sort of, you know, using a slightly higher or lower peating level. It's, you know, you obviously have full control over that. The obvious downside is that that if you are a distillery that produces predominantly unpeated malt, when you do a peated malt run, you're going to have to clean everything out because you don't want your, you know, your standard spirit to be have any peat character whatsoever. So as far as I'm aware, the distillery kind of does this at the end of the season, at the end of the year. They will do a peated run, and then I guess they basically shut down for Christmas, clean everything out, and then start all over again in the new year. So anyway, we have six bottlings of the Kubokan to have a look at, and well, I guess I'll just introduce the range then, shall I? So okay, we're going to kick off with where it all started back in 2003. Now, I don't think this was the first release of Peter Spirit. I think I read somewhere that back in 2010 there was a four-year-old that was released solely for the Japanese market, but I couldn't find any further information out about that one. So I'm not entirely sure whether that was true or not. But anyway, as far as the Kubokan range itself was originated in 2013 with its first release, which had been aged in American oak, bottled at 46%. And like I said, fairly lightly peated, 15 parts per million. So, you know, you expect a little bit of subtle smoke and, you know, a little bit of peat. Incidentally, this whole Kubokan thing is supposedly a legend surrounding the village of Tomatin about a devil dog that terrorised the inhabitants thereof at some period of time. But I love the packaging. I mean, yeah, okay, you can take or leave the myth, shall we say, but because at the end of the day it's what's in the bottle that really counts. But I love the packaging, I love the fact that they've done something completely different to their standard stuff. So anyway, the second bottling we're looking at is the 2015 release, which was solely aged in bourbon cask, or the limited edition bourbon cask. So that is that one bottled at 46%. Then we'll be moving on to the Virgin Oak edition, which obviously was aged in Virgin Oak, again released in 2005 and bottled at 46%. And the last of the no age statement bottlings, this one, this is the sherry matured, So obviously, aged in sherry, bottled at 46%, no chill filtration, etc., etc., as you would expect in from these quality orientated distilleries. So that all of these ones are still currently available, as far as I'm aware. Although, like I said, the sherry, the bourbon, and the virgin oak editions were all limited editions. I forget the number of bottles that were released of them, but I still think they're knocking about, shall we say. So it will be interesting to see how the different cask types kind of influence the spirit. And the final two we'll be looking at are the vintage dated bottlings. This is the sample I was waiting for before I could do this episode of the show. This is this year's release. It was distilled in 2005. Thus making it 11 years old, aged in a combination of American oak and sherry casks, bottled at 50%. So should be interesting to see what the higher ABV does to it. And finally, this is the last one in the series. This one is the 1988. Now, the interesting thing about this one is it's not peated spirit. In actual fact, it is standard unpeated Tomatin whiskey. The only difference is that this has been aged in a combination of ex-American oak, ex-sherry casks from a rather well-known Islay distillery, which unfortunately I can't tell you where they're from. I know which distillery it is, but I've been told that I'm not allowed to reveal that information, but I'm fairly certain that you do a bit of digging, you'll find out where these casks come from. So this is bottled at 51.5% and is 28 years old. So it's kind of an interesting kind of take on the whole Cubochen thing, and it will be interesting to see how different that spirit is to the standard peated spirit, you know. So, you know, it's unpeated spirit aged in ex-peated cask. You'd expect it to be a lot more subtle on the peat. Although in saying that, the standard bottlings are only peated to about 15 parts per million. So I think it's going to be really interesting to when we get to that point. So anyway, I think it's probably about time we start this. Right, okay, so let's kick off with the first bottling and let's see what the nose gives us on this one, shall we? Quite earthy, slightly straw-like, bit of barley. Kind of, it sort of reminds me of the 15-year-old in their standard range, which is again solely aged in American oak, and when I tasted the standard range was probably my least favoured, and it has an edge to it, shall we say. It's not an industrial edge, it's got an edginess which is just kind of rather un-Tomatin like, if you see what I mean. It's standard kind of Tomatin, wonderfully lush, fruity, a bit minerally. The use of American oak and sherry cask together seems to just work really, really nicely with the spirit. But this has got some nice notes to it. It's subtly peated. It's got some nice smokiness. Barley accented, you know. Again, it's got that kind of straw-like kind of character, which kind of seems to sort of hint at more maturity than you would expect, considering this was probably, I'm guessing, some of the early sort of spirit, or maybe probably a combination of the two. I mean, so at the most, 8 years old? There's a touch of coffee, a little bit of sort of, you know, older wood notes kind of coming through. I mean, this is it's really nice. It's really kind of just got a very natural kind of character, which is really, really interesting. Palate? That's a lovely finish. Long, smoky, a little bit ashy. Again, it's probably got a little bit more fruit character than the nose kind of suggests. There's a sort of latent tropical character, and it's not sort of a kind of a terminology I would sort of naturally use with Tomatin. Like I said, it tends to be more barley, mineral, which this certainly has, but it's got a nice weight, a little bit of honey. Very, very long. I mean, that is really, really long. It's really classy, really impressive. Nice progression, not overly peated, but just enough to sort of make you go, yeah, that's a little bit different. Right, okay, so let's move on to the Bourbon Cask Edition. Let's see what the nose gives us on this, see if there's any difference between this one and the original bottling, shall we say. It's softer. The first thing you notice is it's softer. There's a bit more vanilla character. I'm guessing that although these are, would suggest refill American oak casks, I don't think, it certainly doesn't, the aromas are not quite so mature. They certainly don't have quite so much age. So it's got a little bit more fruitiness in actual fact. Nicely mineral. Possibly softer on the peat, although it's still peated to the same parts per million. It's maybe a little medicinal edge to it. Certainly feels younger, like I said. It's certainly more fruity, less straw-like, less mature. But it's lovely. It really is just a lovely spirit. Nicely balanced, not too oaky, not too peaty. And more classically Highland, I think, in that it has more of that kind of mineral vibrancy, and a little bit of citrus. Mm. Palate? Really juicy, really malty, full on the middle. Doesn't taste quite as heavily peated again. Drier peat possibly. Lovely mineral character. Certainly, like I said, the spirit feels younger. It opens out with a little bit more oak character. So again, I'm guessing younger spirit, less refilled American oak casks. Possibly might be the odd first fill one thrown in there. Certainly has that almost kind of vanilla custard kind of character, but then you get the sort of the progression through the barley, the minerality, and just a little bit of smoke right on the very end, like I said. So not quite as much smoke as say the standard bottling, but wonderfully juicy, really, really nice whiskey. That's good stuff. Right, okay, so let's move on to the Virgin Oak Edition. Now, I mean, what was it, about two, three years back now, there seemed to be a rash of Virgin Oak releases by various distilleries, and you know, seemed to become a bit of a fetish. Some of them that really worked quite well, I certainly remember Oppentoschen working really, really nicely in Virgin Oak. Probably the one that you wouldn't expect to work. And then I think you had Glengarry, I think, also came out about the same time, which maybe quite wasn't so successful. But anyway, I love Virgin Oak. So let's see what the nose gives us. Oh yes, grippy, grainy, spicy. This isn't your sort of soft vanilla kind of character. This really has got quite a spicy edge to it. There's some bourbony kind of character beneath that, some rich oak, some butter, a little bit of toffee, but it's all the while it's got that kind of grainy sort of intensity. It is quite a dominating character. I mean, obviously there's no getting away from that. Virgin oak always is going to be it, unless you do something like maybe vat it in with some American oak aged spirit to basically just take the edge off the gritty oak character. It's always going to be sort of quite up there and in your face. But it's got some nice perfume notes, some barley, some apricot. Again, I mean, you know, the Tomatin spirit really does stand up to this really nicely. And again, this is what I've found with their spirit. It works really well, even if you stick it in first fill Oloroso and stuff like that, which obviously the next bottling that we're going to get onto certainly is. So really juicy, little, again, just a real brief whiff of peat smoke, just kind of there, sort of sitting in the background, adding an extra layer of complexity. Really, really nice spirit. This is, I think, sort of by far and away, this is my favourite of the sort of core releases, so to speak. Actually, I'm getting a bit of burnt wood coming out now. The sort of, you know, giving it a bit of aeration is bringing out the sort of burnt wood kind of peat note, which is kind of all being wrapped up in that sort of edgy, spicy oak character. It's like, oh, it's a real intense nose. Lovely, lovely stuff. Pop. Again, a really malty, chewy, spicy finish. A little bit of peat smoke kind of coming through right on the finish. Does again open up with a lot of oak character, a lot of sort of taut vanilla, spice, a little bit of butter. But again, you get to the mid palate, you get the progression through the spirit, through the sort of like the apricot, the minerality. Then it's kind of back to the spice of the oak, which is all being intermingled with a slight peat smoke as well, and the malt, and it's juicy and it's chewy and it's, oh, that is absolutely fantastic. I really, really like that. Yeah, I think that was certainly my favourite of the core range. So yeah, good stuff. Right, and let's move on to the sherry edition. Like I said, this has all been aged in first fill Oloroso, so let's see what the nose gives us then, shall we? A lot of sherry, obviously. You know, you wouldn't expect anything other. But as you can see, it's not sort of like hugely dark. There's a lot darker whiskies I've seen that have been aged in first fill Oloroso. Yes, it's got some dried fruits, licorice, a little bit of treacle. But it seems to have more peat character. Again, as far as I'm aware, this is still the same peating level, 15 parts per million. But maybe the sort of like the sherry oak is kind of, you know, emphasising the peat on the nose. Again, it's nicely balanced for something that's been aged wholly in sherry casks. You certainly get some of the distillery character, some of the minerality, some of the apricot, some of the fleshier fruit notes. A little bit of herbalness kind of coming through now. I mean, that is nice. I mean, you know, I keep saying that the sherry matured whiskies are not, you know, my favourite. I much prefer American oak, but, you know, when you get something that has a lovely balance to it, then, you know, sherry works really nicely. You know, it adds that sort of extra level of complexity. It's only when it, you know, it's overly blanketing and sort of, you know, kind of that's all you can taste. I just find them just a little bit boring. And you can equally say that about American oak aged whiskies. When all you can taste is American oak, you're just sort of going, oh, yeah, okay. No light and shade, but this certainly has it. This is a lovely. Again, really not quite as gritty as the virgin oak, but it has, a lovely natural character with that sort of subtle wood smoke, peat smoke. Palate. Little bit heavier on the sherry character on the palate. The sherry's a little bit darker. It's more sort of prunes, walnuts, dark dried fruits, raisins, that kind of thing. Quite a gritty finish, a little bit of tannin kind of mingling in with the sort of like the grittier sort of peat smoke. Certainly tastes like there's more peat. And again, I'm wondering whether that's actually more about the interaction between the peat and the sherry. I don't know, maybe it's just kind of, you know, emphasizing those kind of grittier kind of peat notes. Pleasantly mineral on the finish, maybe not quite so much distillery character kind of coming through on the palate. It is more seeming to be about the sherry and the peat. But, you know, still, you know, a lovely crafted whiskey, I think. So, so yeah, really, really pleasant. Right, okay, so let's move on to the 11-year-old. So this is going to be from some of the first peated spirit that they, the distillery produced. So it'll be interesting to see where we're at with it. A nice nose, kind of sherry notes up front. It's got a lovely softness, but again, sort of a slight grittiness to it, a little bit of herbalness, touch of vanilla kind of underneath. Again, like I said, I think the distillery seems to be very, very competent in the use of both American oak and sherry cask, certainly when they're putting their vattings together. It's got a slight straw-like character to it. Sort of, there is an element that's a bit like the very first release that we tasted. So it's certainly got that maturing edge to it. A little bit of smoke kind of coming through again. It's all very subtle. A little bit of mineral. Getting a little bit of kind of green citrus fruit. A little bit of maybe gooseberry. It's that kind of sort of, again, that sort of slightly herbally Oloroso note coming through. Actually really quite complex. Very, very interesting. Again, sort of really well balanced, which is what I'm always on about. And yeah, that's a nice nose. Palate. Love that intensity. That a little bit more alcohol is just giving it a cleansing character, because it opens up with the sherry and the darker sherry notes, the prune, the walnuts, the raisins, hits the mid palate. Extra intensity of alcohol just kind of clears it away a little bit, allows the American oak aged spirit to come through, and getting a little bit of apricot and getting a lot of minerality, a lot of crisp, fresh mineral notes. Quite mouth-watering. Again, very subtle on the peat, just a kind of almost brief smokiness on the finish. So all really, really nicely wrapped up, it has to be said. And I just that extra alcohol just gives it that little bit more punch, that sort of lovely mouth-watering juicy finish. That's not to say that the 46% bottlings are lacking anything, not at all. I think it's just that's a lovely ABV to bottle at. That 50% is just all like, ooh, it's just got that extra little bit of to it, as they say. So yeah, really very, very good. Love that one. And finally, we're on to the 1988. So this is, you know, unpeated. So you could argue this is not really Kubokan at all. It's kind of, you know, kind of masquerading. It's a wolf in dog's clothing, so to speak. So let's see what if any difference that we get between the actual peated spirit and unpeated spirit matured in Exiler casks. So let's see when those goes. Briny. That's the thing that I get straight off the bat. I get brininess, which you just don't get in the standard in the other bottlings for obvious reasons. Quite herbal. Almost botanical, medicinal, slightly more medicinal, the peat kind of level is almost about the same. It's definitely different. I mean, it's very different. You know, it doesn't have that sort of softer peat smoke kind of character. It's got a definite medicinal kind of edge to it. I tell you what, I think you'd be hard pressed to sort of, you know, pick this as a 28-year-old spirit. It has just such wonderful vibrancy. There's a little bit of damp earth, a little bit of straw kind of coming through, so it's kind of hinting at maturity, but I think it's because of the sort of the herbal nature, that sort of kind of herbally medicinal kind of character is certainly distracting from the maturity of the spirit. And yes, you kind of like sort of ignore that and you can say, well, yeah, I'm getting some of that sort of damp straw and earth and kind of classic sort of mature American oak aged Tomatin kind of coming through. It's just got that real salty vibrancy, and you kind of like try to ignore it, but it's just kind of going, no, I'm still here. Little bit of burnt wood. Am I getting a bit of almost conserve, kind of apricot-y, orangey kind of conserve? Very woody, really smoky and woody, wood smoke. Yeah, that's a lovely nose. Really quite impressive. Palate. Salty, really, really salty. Fresh, crisp, slightly medicinal again, like I said, burnt wood, coastal character. I'm really amazed at how much influence that these casks have actually had over the spirit. Totally, totally different. Real intensity, yes, it's bottled at slightly higher ABV at 51.5. All nicely integrated though, certainly a real salty finish to it. But that has really changed the character of it, and it is very, very noticeably different from the other bottlings in the Kubokan range. It's different, you know. It's I wouldn't say it's better or worse or anything like that. It is just completely different. It's, I guess, if you didn't know that they were ex-Isla cast, you might think that the peat that they were using was probably slightly different. I mean, I would guess that the peated the peat that is used for malting the barley is Highland peat. It certainly has that drier kind of character that I associate with mainland peat, rather than the more salty, sort of astringent, medicinal notes that Isla peat kind of gives you. But even so, really, really impressive. That's a lovely whiskey. Just completely different from the rest of the range, and I'm guessing that's part of the attraction. So yeah, nice one to finish on. Right, okay, so let's sum this little tasting up. I found this really interesting. I mean, I hope you guys found it interesting as well. I mean, it's always a difficult one, because when you have sort of bottlings that are released over, you know, a number of years, although you have a residual memory bank of what the first one tasted like, it's just quite an eye-opener to sort of taste them all against each other, all side by side. And I must admit, at the time, I probably didn't think about it so much, but there is certainly some maturity in that initial Kubokan bottling. So it's obviously got some of the 2005 distilled spirit. So, like I said, we'd probably been about 8 years old at the time, but certainly tasted a lot older. So that was quite impressive. The American oak, obviously younger spirit, slightly more active casks, more vanilla, you know, more crispness, more freshness, you know, again, just a really nice bottling. I still think I'm going to go with the virgin oak as my favourite, actually, out of all of these, although in saying that, I did love the 88. I mean, I love that sort of islery kind of character, but it's too different from the rest of the range. What I love about the Kubokan range is the fact that it is very Highland. It isn't an islet. It's not a whiskey trying to pretend to be an islet, if you see what I mean. It has a very distinctive Highland character and Highland peat kind of character. And the virgin oak just worked really nicely, really spicy, drew out the spiciness in the peat character, which I thought was really, really nice. In saying that, in actual fact, I thought the sherry matured one was very, very good. Again, somehow that sherry cask had kind of pulled out more intensity of peat character, which is just really quite surprising. And you would expect it to be the other way around. And first fill Oloroso, you would have, again, expected it to be very blanketing, very, very Oloroso-y. But in actual fact, was really very, very nicely balanced and really impressive. Talking of balance leads us into the first of the two vintage dated bottlings, the 2005. Again, you know, just what Tomatin does really, really well, and that is the use of sherry casks and American oak casks. Perfectly balanced, not too much sherry, not too much American oak, just really, really nice. And the 88, like I said, it kind of stands out once you've tasted them all sort of side by side. I mean, on its own, it's a great whiskey. It's lovely. Again, really well balanced, medicinal, intense, very, very salty. But what I'm trying to say is it's kind of stands out too much, if you see what I mean, as it's too different. Yet, like I said, if you kind of look at it as a bottling in its own right, and you taste it as a bottling in its own right, and a whiskey in its own right, it's very, very good. I'm not going to argue about the quality of that. It's just too different from the rest of the range. It's an interesting experiment, I will give it that. But it just tastes like an islet, and I'm really surprised at how much character those casks have actually imparted upon the whiskey. And like I said to you, it tastes more like an islet. It's less like a peated Highland malt, which the rest of the range actually is. So It, like I said, it's horses for courses, and it's only now, you know, tasting it within the entire range, you suddenly go, that is just so different. And, you know, I don't think it's a bad thing. I just personally prefer the rest of the range, because it's just not more authentic, but like I said, it tastes more like a peated Highland malt rather than a malt that's trying to be like an Islay. But, you know, still, like I said, really, really good whiskey, really enjoyable, and it certainly shouldn't put you off buying it if you love that kind of style. So there you have it. That's this week's episode of the Show in the Bag. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you will check out the peated Tomatin range, the Keebokan range, because they are really fabulous whiskies. Like I said, you know, it seems to me that Tomatin is certainly on a roll at the moment and can do no wrong, shall we say. Finally, I would just like to say, you know, a really big thank you. Obviously not all of these samples come from the distillery, but the bulk of them do. And you know, new release comes out, I don't even have to ask the question most of the time. You know, a little package will turn up with a sample in, and always just, you know, really thankful for distilleries taking the time to do that, because at the end of the day, they don't have to. But you know, and we've not been dealing with Tomatin directly for, you know, for a relatively short period of time, but certainly in that period of time, they've certainly become a favourite of mine, and we have a shelf full of their spirit, including batch 2 of the 36-year-old, which is unbelievably good, and I have a little bit of a leftover sample, so no doubt that will come into an episode of the show in due course. Anyway, so I think I've waffled enough today. Like I said, I hope you've enjoyed this episode of the show. I hope you guys at the distillery, if you're watching it, have enjoyed the review that I've done, because I think this is probably pretty unique. I don't think anybody else has done a review of the entire Keebokan range. So, yeah, I hope you guys have enjoyed it. So all that's left to say is good dramming, and good afternoon.